The case of Smith versus State, which is found at 28 Southern Third, 838, a Florida Supreme Court case from 2010, which is the case involving Carly Brucia, who was a young girl abducted at a car wash in Sarasota. The issue of whether or not family members had engaged in conduct making them agents of law enforcement was discussed. And in that case, Smith, the defendant's brother, was asked at one point during an interview with an FBI agent whether or not he had ever thought about going to see the defendant and asking him if he had done this or killed Carly Brucia. The brother of Mr. Smith in that circumstance indicated to the FBI that he did not believe Mr. Smith would confess unless someone tricked him into doing so. And the brother informed the FBI that he wanted to see the defendant. The FBI, in turn, told him that the defendant had a lawyer and that the meeting would have to go through the lawyer. And the next day, the public defender, Mr. Smith's agent, much like Mr. Baez was Ms. Anthony's agent in this case, arranged a meeting between the defendant, Mr. Smith, his brother, and his mother. Law enforcement didn't debrief them, they didn't surveil them, they didn't ask them about the meeting. The brother apparently thought that the FBI was bugging his phone and on his own contacted the FBI about locating the child's body based upon what his brother told him. The Florida Supreme Court goes through the factors to consider in determining whether or not Mr. Smith's brother acted as an agent of law enforcement. And in fact, what it said was Mr. Smith, because he had his own purpose, in that case, a nefarious one, it seems, maybe trying to profit off of locating the child's body before law enforcement did, that his actions belied any suggestion that he was acting as an agent of law enforcement. In fact, in the cases referenced in Garner, the federal cases, Koenig, Pfeffer, and Shahid, the ultimate question is whether or not that if private parties pursue the same objectives as government officials, they can do so without acquiring the status of a government agent. And that even if there are some purposes, private purposes, that coincide with the purpose of government, the language is that this happy coincidence does not make a private actor an arm of the government. It is clear that regardless of the actions of the Orange County Sheriff, of the Federal Bureau of Investigation, that if they would have stopped their investigation and determined that this was a family matter, that George Anthony, Cindy Anthony, and Lee Anthony would have continued on the path that they had already chosen for themselves, and that was to get information from Casey Anthony. That they were acting independent of law enforcement and with no active encouragement from them. As such, they cannot be determined or deemed to be agents of law enforcement, and therefore any statements that they obtained that were audiotaped or videotaped in the normal course, where Detective Melich asked that every interview be recorded, should be admissible in this case.
Mr. Mason.
I find it somewhat, never mind. Let me go to some of the initial points that are important. The state has not paid attention, apparently, to the case of Cox versus State, 666, strike that. It's 26 Southern Report of Third Series, page 666, 2010 decision, dealing with these issues, Fourth District, and says it's, the burden is on the state to prove a voluntary, knowing, and intelligent relinquishment of the Sixth Amendment right to counsel. Here we have it. It's not ours. Next, counsel has argued about this timeline, and relying upon this timeline to say that we have problems with our argument. Well, we looked at it, and fortunately I have some assistance with the little electronic things back there. And what we found out is that looking at this Tiburon timeline, they argued, why Mr. Eberlin apparently took three of these statements before he even arrived. Says he didn't arrive until 22:42, but the statements are done between 22:11 and 22:16. Now I'm confused. And then on the next page of this document, they've got going through all these people arriving, just as an example. Hosey REQ, I don't know what that means, request, I presume, OPD watch commander at 145. Fletcher at Hope Spring, 148. Melich at Hope Spring, 351. First tape statement of defendant, 411. We get down here, three things down there. It says, Melich to Universal, blank. Allen and Wells to Hope Spring, blank. Allen and Wells to Universal, blank. So it would seem to me that, and she's arrested at 4:33 in the afternoon, when I said they with her until the crack of dawn, and see Melich closed the call at 6:42, that's probably pretty close to crack of dawn, thereabout. And then the rest of the timelines are blank. So there's something wrong with that. Now, I don't think it's reliable to be talking about who did what when. What we know is, on this argument about custody, is Deputy Acevedo answered four or five questions of mine in succession about what was going on between her and Casey, why Casey was in her custody. Quote. And she responded to all of those. When Miss Burdick gets up to cross-examine her and this kind of looking like she's caught in the headlights like a deer, Miss Acevedo said, oh no, she wasn't in custody. She wasn't in custody. When she wasn't aware of problem she calls for her side, she said she was in custody. Well, it doesn't really matter. It's for you to decide on those facts. She's patted down. She's put in that car. Lady calls it a cage. She's driven around. I doubt you're going to go out here and find anybody that's going to say they're not in custody. Not a soul. I want to point out to you also, by the way, you asked me about Parks' case. Once again, nice thing about having these folks with these little electronic gadgets. Well, I just read that case. And that gentleman was handcuffed and shackled. And then when they realized that something was wrong, they released him, told him specifically, you are now free to go, and advised him of his Miranda warning rights. That's a whole bunch different than what we have here. Counsel makes a continued argument that Miss Anthony, when she left the house to go to Detective Melich's car for this ride, she walked on her own free will, her power, meaning they didn't pick her up and carry her, or they didn't drag her. Well, of course she did. Judge, look at this guy. He's a big guy. And he's got a gun, and he's got a partner, and he says, come with me now, we're going to go here. You go show us this, and you show us that. Her own free will, indeed.